Apex Express, Asian Pacific Expression.
Community and cultural coverage.
Music and calendar.
New visions and voices.
Coming to you with an Asian Pacific Islander point of view.
It's time to get on board the Apex Express.
Greetings, folks. Welcome to Apex Express, news and views with an API point of view. On tonight's South Asia Spotlight, we find out how yet another batch of base alums, or the Bay Area Solidarity Summer alums, found the unique social justice summer camp that happens every August for 5 days for South Asian American youth in Oakland. We also celebrate radio producer Sonali Kolhatkar's new show, Uprising with Sonali, that will now air on Free Speech TV. We end tonight's show with an arts exhibition update by Apex producer Robin Takiyama. I'm your host and producer tonight, Preeti Mangla Shekhar. Keep it locked down here on 94.1 FM. We begin tonight's South Asia Spotlight with radio producer Sonali Kolhatkar, who's no stranger to KPFA airwaves. She joins us here tonight to discuss with me how journalists of color often have to struggle to make their voices heard and to make their presence felt, even in progressive media circles. And she's a longtime host and producer who began her career with Radio Uprising and has gone on to have her own television news show. Are you here with us, Sonali?
Yes, I am.
So congratulations on having your new show getting featured on Free Speech Radio News. I just saw the update on Free Speech TV, sorry. Free Speech TV. So it's an exciting update. So congratulations. And can you begin
Thank
by
you.
Telling us about your path to radio journalism from the world of the sciences?
Yeah. Many, many years ago now, I was an astronomy major. I graduated with several degrees in astronomy and physics, and I was working at Caltech when I became a listener of KPFK Pacifica, your sister station here in Southern California, where I'm based. And one thing led to another. I was wanting to do something more meaningful in my life. I actually gave a whole TED talk about my journey from astronomer to radio journalist. But the sort of nutshell story is that I became very involved with Afghan women's rights and the war in Afghanistan. I did a lot of public speaking about it, and was approached by a couple of my friends who thought I might be a good radio host, which at the time I thought was, you know, kind of a ludicrous notion. But then the more I thought about it, the more attractive it became. And I found myself at KPFK with a reworked resume in hand. And as luck would have it, I was in the right place at the right time. And I was offered the opportunity to try out for the morning show host, because their morning show host was leaving. They liked me and I stayed. And that was in 2002. And I was hosting a show called The Morning Show. And then in 2003, I started Uprising. And then earlier this year, I changed that name because of various reasons to my own brand, Rising Up with Sonali, Uprising had been on Free Speech TV for about a year or so, and then for various reasons, the show got canceled last year. Now we're very excited to be back on Free Speech TV, rebranded, Rising Up with Sonali, and it's going to debut on Monday, and I'm very excited about it.
Absolutely. I know it's not been an easy path, even though, you know, it's it makes for a great TED Talk, I'm sure. So the other reason, Sonali, when I saw your update on Facebook about being on Free Speech TV, I was excited, was earlier this morning I was listening to a show with where Juan Gonzalez was talking about the struggle of progressive media to embrace journalists of color and how it remains largely white. So I was wondering if you could share your own reflections and you know, especially as a woman of color, as an immigrant woman of color, it's not an easy path to kind of make forays, especially in radio journalism, where things you know, accent and perspectives are so racialized.
Absolutely. I mean, I had a conversation with an unnamed NPR affiliate, let's put it that way, about you know, getting a job in at their radio station. This was just a few years ago, and the person knew very well who I was, and remarked to me, in, I think he was trying to pay me a compliment, and you barely noticed your accent. I mean, you know, I said, well, even right. If I had a stronger accent, why would that be a problem if I'm clearly understood? It certainly wouldn't be something that one might raise, say, with a British journalist or you know, somebody with a European background. And absolutely, journalists of color have major struggles. I feel like I've perhaps been luckier than most with my break at Pacifica, which I think Pacifica is the only place that could give a lucky break like this to a journalist of color. But after that was basically my one and only big break. And then since then, it's been an uphill battle. Foundations, it's really hard to get foundations to give money, because here's the deal. If you're a person who is connected, if you're a white American, if you have family money, chances are you have been raised in an atmosphere, gone to a university where you have connections to money, and you know somebody who knows somebody who knows somebody who might have access to money, and then all of a sudden your connection to foundation money, which can give people a lot of freedom and sometimes not, can be much easier than somebody like me who's trying to break in. I don't live in New York or DC, where a lot of foundation money is, and for me to have to, and I've tried, you know, spent now years trying to convince foundations to give a progressive show like mine, run by two women, you know, hosted by a woman of color, immigrant woman of color, and I can't make any headway because most of them say, well, we're already giving money to Democracy Now. And of course, you know, Democracy Now! Is one of the most important programs we have out there, but we need more shows than Democracy Now! Mm-hmm. You know, we need a diversity, a variety of shows. We need women-run shows. We need all-women shows. We need women of color behind the microphones. And so that's been the biggest challenge. And also, when you're a woman of color and you're a smart woman of color, you tend to antagonize white authority figures, whether you intend to or not. Your mere presence, your existence is sometimes seen as a threat, even to people who claim to be anti-racist, but, you know, find themselves stamping on your ambition or stamping on your opportunities because they can, because they have power over you, and probably because they threaten those positions. And so I've seen that so many times. And of course, I can't give specifics. I have to speak in generalities. But I'm sure, Preeti, you've experienced those same issues. It's not easy out there.
Yeah, absolutely. And I remember interning with a very popular show on KQED here and feeling very intimidated because I was the lone immigrant woman with an accent, and I had to make sure I was very, very clear. I was very, very slow. And, you know, I was more self-conscious than the other, you know, interns. So,
look, we have to work so much harder to get the same thing that other folks, you know, are able to take for granted. We have to work much harder to prove ourselves. Studies show already, we already know the studies show that when when employers get resumes, that there is a significant bias away from foreign sounding names. African Americans have it very bad in media, especially, you know, people of color in general, but African Americans, immigrants, if you have a foreign sounding name or a black sounding name, you're much less likely to get a job offer than a white person or a person with a white sounding name who has the exact same qualifications and credentials as you. And if that holds in the job market, it certainly holds in so many other arenas as well. Then if you're a woman on top of that, you have that added burden as well.
Absolutely. So what does it mean for your show to be on Free Speech TV? What does it mean for you?
Well, Free Speech TV is one of those progressive outlets that found itself dominated by almost entirely white men, with a few female exceptions, and almost no women of almost no journalists of color. Elon James has been one presence on there, but certainly no women of color. And they did the right thing, you know, unlike many progressive news outlets, sadly, they did the right thing by seeking to diversify themselves, and my show is one start. And they have admitted very openly that this is a problem with their lineup, and they are working to fix it. So I'm really, you know, I'm proud to be that person to help them fix that, but I'm also proud that they're and admiring of them that they are admitting that this is an issue that they need to fix. They've also taken troubles to diversify their own staff, which I think is a really important thing. It's not just the people, you know, on camera that need to be diverse, but the decision makers as well. So they have a wonderful new African-American general manager, Nina Moore, who I've been working closely with. She's new to the team. So those sorts of efforts, those are really important. And I'm very proud to be part of this new endeavor. And you know, I hope other progressive news outlets follow the lead of FSTV. They ought to look at, you know, if it's a print outlet, for example, are we tending to publish mostly white journalists and white writers? If we're a publishing house, are we tending to publish books by mostly white writers or white male writers? If so, we need to fix that right away.
Right. And speaking of writing, I know that you also publish and write for Truth Out and other publications. So it's
Truth Dig.
Yeah. So it's not easy because you have to be constantly churning out stuff.
I do. I write a weekly column for Truth Dig. You know, when my kids are in bed once a week, I spend 3-4 hours writing a 1,200 word column on a story of the week that I think I need to shine a light on. And even there, even at Truth Dig, it was the same thing. Here was an outlet that realized that most of its weekly columnists were white folks, mostly white men, some white women, and they wanted to fix that. And I was grateful that they came to me with an opportunity because it's a paid writing gig, you know, modest pay, but still, it's really tough these days to find a paid writing gig, especially for print journalists of color. It's almost impossible in an online outlet as well. So again, I'm grateful too that there are outlets like Free Speech TV and Truth Dig out there that are trying to do the right thing and trying to bring on more diversity, and while remaining very staunchly progressive, because that's very important to me, you know, more than anything, before anything else, my political views, my background, my approach, my perspectives, being staunchly progressive and left is very important to me.
Absolutely. And you inspire many of us who want to continue being in media and not give up. So thank you so much. And we've also cross-shared a couple of your segments on our show on Apex Express. So, and I'm sure many of our listeners know about your show, but as you go out, can you tell us how listeners can find out about your show?
Absolutely. It airs on KPFA every morning, 8 a.m. to 9 a.m. I've been very grateful to KPFA for being an outlet for my show. And we have our own website at risingupwithsonali.com. And all of our interviews are now videotaped as well. We're not just a radio show, but a TV show as well. Since March, we've been an online TV show. And on Monday, that online TV show actually goes on to a bona fide television channel, Free Speech TV. So risingupwithsonali.com. Preeti, thank you for your solidarity, for all the work you do. And I really appreciate you having me on.
Oh, thank you so much. And thanks so much for taking time out of dinner to come talk to us and let you go. Thank you so much, Sonali.
Take care, Preeti.
Take care. So that was radio producer Sonali Kulhatkar. Check out her new show, Rising Up with Sonali, that will now air on Free Speech TV as well. We go for a small music break and then we sit down to discuss Bay Area Solidarity Summer or BASE. Stay tuned. So, to discuss Bay Area Solidarity Summer, or BASE, which is in its sixth year of training and engaging with South Asian American youth and social justice in Oakland every year, I have three special guests in studio with us today. So it's a little bit of a party in here. I'll quickly read their bios before diving into a discussion with them. I have in here with me Robin Gurung, who's a community organizer, life coach, and the founder and current president of a nonprofit called Foundation for Conscious Activism that aims to empower youth activists to engage in inner transformation to social transformation. Robin migrated to the U.S. in 2012 from a Bhutanese refugee camp in Nepal, where he spent 20 years of his life, and currently works with a Bay Area Bhutanese Youths, or BABY as the acronym goes, where Bhutanese refugees, youths in the Bay Area come together to discuss different social challenges in their community and look for different ways to empower their community. He's also a student at Niroga Institute for yoga teachers training here in Berkeley, and he's also continuing his bachelor's degree in applied social sciences at Colorado State University's Global Campus. Well, welcome to our show, Robin.
Thank you.
Also here with us is Sagari Jain, a senior at UC Berkeley, studying history, especially the history of the British Empire, colonialism, race and gender in India and Africa. She loves poetry, cooking and radical South Asian work. She hopes to be many things, including a writer, an educator and a historian. Welcome, Sagari.
Thank you.
And finally, we have Kavleen Singh, a third year political science student at UC Berkeley, local. So welcome, Kavleen.
Thank you.
So, and in full disclosure, I've been a part of BASE for the last few years as a volunteer, primarily in the kitchen, as I love to cook myself and engage with youth through food. So it's been a joy every year to hang out at BASE, meet young social justice, curious South Asian youths like yourselves. So I want to ask each of you how you found out about BASE. Maybe Kavleen, can we begin with you?
Yeah, sure. I found out about BASE initially through an email from my cousin last year, who suggested that it would eventually be something that I would be interested in doing in the future. And so I applied for this year's BASE, and luckily I got in, and I was super happy about that. And so, yeah, that's how I found out about BASE.
Robin?
Well, I work with the youth in my community, and then one of the youth she knew about this program and wanted to participate last year, and she couldn't join for some reason. And then this year she just informed us through Facebook, and then I look at the program and it just kind of grabbed my attention.
Great. Sagri?
Well, I've been in Berkeley a couple years, and about a year ago, a friend and I, both of which who joined BASE, were working on building activist community for South Asian, Southwest Asian, and North African folks. We called it SWANAs for Social Justice. And when I was thinking about how to address things like Dalit issues and gender in South Asia and bring interesting guest speakers, everyone forwarded me to one of the organizers of BASE, Anirvan Chatterjee. He and his wife, Barnali, also work, do the Radical South Asian Walking
and
Tour.
And we have featured them a number of times on our show.
Yeah, thank really
you.
Cool
thank
people.
Thank you for highlighting them.
So that was how I found it. And really it was Anirvan who kept up and sent out the link and encouraged everyone to apply. We're really grateful for that.
Great. And a little bit of context for our listeners who may not have caught some of our updates around about BASE in previous years' shows. BASE targets youth, South Asian youth aged 18 to 23. And by South Asia, we mean the countries of India, Pakistan, Nepal, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Sri Lanka, and sometimes I think Afghanistan and Burma, but you know, primarily these 6 to 7 countries, and the diaspora that's in the Caribbean and the Pacific. And it was formed by mentors who wanted to grow organizers, and also as a response to so many other avenues that are available for more right-wing, fundamentalist-inspired trainings that happen in the South Bay and other, you know, across the U.S. too. So, BASE is inspired by Youth Solidarity Summer in New York, Rad Desi Summer in Austin, Texas, and organizing youth in the SF Bay Area. And also has contemporaries on the East Coast, like East Coast Solidarity Summer and Chicago DC Youth Rising in Chicago. So coming back to our discussion, maybe Sagari, we can begin with you. What made you want to apply, and what were some of the maybe couple of key learnings for you through the camp? Was it transformative, or how was it for you?
Yeah, I think that I wanted to apply because I feel like in my life I've been lucky enough to be in a lot of spaces with progressive people who are envisioning a better, racially just, classless world. And I've been in a lot of spaces where it was full of South Asian people. And, you know, you have the food and you have a shared set of experiences and everyone calls each other auntie and uncle. And I was so excited to see both of those things happen at the same time. And I don't feel like I've ever seen both of those things happen at the same time before this weekend. So that was everything to me, finding a community where I felt so at home and so understood. And that was what was transformative for me.
Okay. And Robin, what made you want to apply, and what were some of the key things you learned?
Well, when I migrated to this country in 2012, I was like, to be honest, like for 2 years, I didn't feel like I belonged to this country because of lots of language challenge, cultural kind of challenges. And I spent my entire life engaging in different kind of activism. And when I came to this country, I felt lost. And then I was looking for communities. I was looking for like-minded young leaders who are working with for different social issues. So when I look at the base description, it kind of really attracted my mind because I feel like this is where I want to put my energy. This is I feel like this is where I can find my co-workers. So that was my expectation when I joined, and I'm really glad that I found many young leaders who are really passionate about social change. So some of the key learnings, the whole entire BASE program was very transformative for me. The first thing was like learning about my own identity, exploring my own identity as a brown person. I never thought myself as a brown and exploring throughout the training, like what it means to be a brown person in this kind of linear black and white society. That was very empowering for me to understand where do I exist between this black and white society, and then what is my relationship as a brown person with the black folks, and then how can we build black-brown solidarity, and how can we be an ally and then fight or confront the white privileges, and understanding that white privileges is our enemy but not the white folks was another empowering for realization for me. And also understanding, learning about different campaign strategies, how to organize campaigns, how to work with teams. It was also very empowering for me, and which I'm hoping to bring those strategies and skills in my community and work with the youth in my community.
Great. That's and you also ended up giving us a whiff of what happened during the camp days. So thank you. Kavleen, can you share what made you want to apply and what were some of your learnings?
Yeah, of course. I wanted to apply because I attended Sikh youth camps, mostly with a Jagara movement.
Tell us a little bit more about that, a context to it.
Okay, so Jagara movement is a grassroots youth organization aimed at Sikh youth that focuses on our issues. And it's basically how BASE organizes youth, but Jagara focuses more on a lens regarding Sikhism. And so I would attend those, and we would learn about our own like radical history from a Sikh lens, so much narrower than what BASE discusses. And then that as a kid, that would always inspire me to learn more about my origins. And so when I learned about bass, I figured this was an amazing way to experience what gave me so much joy in my childhood, but learn beyond just my what my Sikh heritage is. And I'm really happy to have accomplished that over there. It's very there's many groups in the South Asian region that do not get much of a voice when it comes to discussing history or even like modern day issues. And one of the things that was really interesting is that the Sri Lankan people admonished that India is always talked about. Like, why don't we talk about any of the other countries? It's always India that's talked about, which is true. Like, India is overrepresented, and then all these other people in the surrounding South Asian area aren't as represented. So for them to be able to get that representation at base was really awesome. I think I'm getting ahead of the question here, but yeah, that's basically what made me apply to base, was just I love learning about history, and I love confronting my, like, how it relates to my existence here. And that kind of goes hand in hand with what was transformative about base, is that it's such an amazing way to build camaraderie. It's also because we entered without acknowledging our differences, really. It's not like people were saying, like, oh, hey, I'm Punjabi, or hey, I'm Sri Lankan, or hey, I'm Malayali, or anything. It's just like, oh, hey, we're all brown, and we're just here to learn. And I think that was cool.
Very cool. And I just want to also give a shout out to the core of BASE. Comprises about almost 10 people this year. Aditi Shakarwar, Kitana Ananda, Shandhya Jha, Virali Modi Parekh, Kriti Garg, Anirvan Chatterjee, Anu Mandavali, Nupur Modi Parekh, Vivek Bharatan, and Zuha Khan, who's also of BASE alum herself, who all came together. And it's, I know, literally a labor of love. As they come together a year ahead of the next BASE and spend a lot of volunteer time, evenings and weekends, pouring a lot of time, effort and energy, planning the curriculum, planning the structure, recruiting volunteers, fundraising. And it's a very accessible camp. So I want to really give a shout out to the core and also the volunteers who make it happen. So, Sagari, going back to you again, or maybe let's start with Robin this time. Mm-hmm. How do you plan to apply what you have learned in your work and activism? You're already doing so much, and I was so impressed to read your bio. What do you think BASE has helped you in your own work going forward?
Well, it has definitely changed my life. One of my dream is to apply those skills that I learned in this program through our nonprofit Foundation for Conscious Activism, and then where we are aiming to connect as many young leaders in our community and discuss about different social issues, and then maybe run some campaigning or organize some different awareness programs. So that is one of my main focus right now. And then to go a little bit further, another little bit long-term dream is to my community, there has been lots of traumas and unresolved wounds in our community, going back to 20 years in the refugee camps, and then going back to 1990s, where our people, like more than 100,000 people, were expelled.
Do you mind if I pause you and ask you to give us a context of how this situation came about?
Mm-hmm. I was born in Bhutan, and Bhutan is a very tiny country. Many people in this country don't know Bhutan, and if they know, then they only know that country as the country where everybody is happy. So it's
stereotypes.
Well, the notion that gross national happiness kind of is like overshadowing the sad stories that took place in 1990s. At the time, like more than 100,000 people from the country were expelled. So, which means like Nepali-speaking Bhutanese people from that country. And so many people were tortured and, you know, like forced to go out of the country. And then they ended up living in 7 different refugee camps in Nepal. So where, like, I was only 3 years old when I was expelled, and then I kind of spent my 20 years in that refugee camp. So, and I can see how the traumas, the tragedies is affecting our generation and how it's affecting the elder generation. And I can also see that it's gonna, if it's not healed properly, then it's going to transmit to the other upcoming generations too, right? So, and one of the big kind of indication of that was in 2014 and 15 in America, our community, Bhutanese refugee community in America, had the highest suicide rate and highest depression rate. So that is the indication
among
that...
Among immigrant communities?
Yes, among the other different immigrant communities. So we want to bring youth in our community to work together to intervene this this kind of social issues, and we want to work together for social healings. So I'm hoping that whatever I learned from BASE, I'm hoping to apply in my own community.
Sort of at the intersection of social justice and healing.
Right.
That's wonderful. Wonderful. Mm-hmm. And Berkeley is a great place to do that. So, what about you, Sagri?
I mean, there's a few things. I spoke earlier about community, and that is really, really important to me. And I think one of the things that BASE encouraged me to do and showed me I was able to do is connect activist community on the Cal campus, which I'm very invested in and love a lot, to activist community in Berkeley, in Oakland, because I think we have very interesting things to learn from each other. And it's so empowering for young, progressive type South Asian people who have taken a couple classes and read some Asian American theory to be able to see adults who have carried out that theory in their life and live according to, like, very rigorous and just ideals. That was really amazing for me. But I also think that, and I'm also thinking through it right now, listening to Robin discuss his communities and his aims. It's easy in being South Asian in this country to read seminal texts about race and not see yourself in them and assume that you're marginal. Assume that your experience is never the center of the discussion and that you will forever occupy an uncomfortable marginal place when people say, why is this room full of white people? So I think that I learned at BASE a certain kind of comfort in finding community that was all trying to work through the questions of what we are and what we're doing here. And I think that's going to help me write things and say things and have conversations with my communities at Cal where we accept just for a couple moments a place where we understand, like, we are just for a couple moments the center of what it means to be American, and say Asian Americans have an amazing place in this country. Asian Americans have been here since 1680. Asian Americans have been a seminal part of racial justice in California especially, and we're not uncomfortable. We know what we're supposed to be, and we know we have a history behind us that includes amazing activists like the ones Anirvan and Barnali talk about on the tour.
Absolutely. And it also made me think about some of the workshops that happened during camp while I was in and out of the kitchen, and I got a sneak peek of the feminism workshop, and I was thinking how rich the analysis was, and I remember thinking how in my own early 20s I was never so sophisticated or complex, and I'm so amazed at the younger generation like y'all who have so much nuance already. So I can't wait to see how you will be, you know, 10 years from now. It's, you know, so power to you. And Kavleen, your thoughts, your learnings, or how do you plan to apply this?
There's a lot of ideas swirling in my head, so it's hard to be concise, but I'll try. Right now, I just plan on self-enrichment because although I have like I'm learning this information. I'm still grappling with the knowledge that I've acquired, and I'm still working through it. So I don't think right now I'm at a good place to really put that into charge. I think personally I need to understand for myself what it all means before I can and help other people with it. I think in the situation that I was in base, I think it was me that needed helping. It wasn't like me going there to like learn how to like help others with the information I already knew. Like I was the one being helped. Like I was kind of like it, like even though a lot of the topics were so familiar to me, I still felt it was like brand new, and I still felt very awakened. And I'm even though it was kind of a week ago, but I'm still like reeling over,
still chewing, yeah. Reflecting. That's true. Yeah, there's a lot of food for thought.
It is. So.
And and to our listeners, the camp just concluded, I think, last week on the 15th of August, right?
Yes.
So fair enough. So maybe we'll have you back next year to share, you know, what you've begun to do with all the rich analysis and learnings.
Yeah, sure.
As we wind down, I was wondering if maybe we can begin with, do you want to go, Robin? Any closing thoughts about BASE and your own work? And also, what would you say as words of advice to, you know, a young South Asian who's listening to our show and wondering if they should apply to BASE next year?
Well, I want to say thank you to all the organizers who organized this amazing program. It was intense, but very powerful. At the same time, to the young activists who are exploring activists, I think one of the key realizations in my life is when you are out there working for social change, we tend to forget about our own traumas, own triggers, and own negative patterns. So just to be aware, you know, I just want to say that be aware of your own traumas and negative patterns, that so that it might not be that cloud that affects your activism, because sometimes we run for social change and at the same time we are kind of unknowingly repeating the same cycle, right? So self-healing, self-care, and self-transformation is very important. And and for that, BASE is the right program. So I, to all the South Asian young activists, check out this program and you will have a transformative experience. Yeah.
Great. Sagari, what are your closing thoughts?
So one of the other things that I took from BASE was that for the last week, maybe week and a half, I've been feeling really creative. I've been painting a lot and writing a lot, and I feel like in that community I found a lot of things to anchor me and remind me that what I have to say is important. So that's what I would want to say to young people trying to apply to BASE and trying to figure out their place in the world, is that trust yourself, trust your voice, and trust that where your values are coming from, they can be lived out. And if you see things wrong, speak up. And, you know, maybe most importantly, we talked a lot about the model minority myth and how Asian Americans are often pigeonholed as the minorities that come to this country and become doctors and lawyers and are not like those other minorities. And you don't have to be that model minority if you don't want to. It's a hard journey explaining that to your community, explaining that to your parents, but you can be all the things that you dream of, even if you never see them represented in your skin color. So apply and trust yourself.
Thank you. Kavleen, any closing thoughts?
For anyone considering applying to BASE, I highly, highly recommend it, because it will really stretch your brain and make you if there's any inkling of doubt and like I think it was mentioned before, just not seeing yourself represented in a way that like makes you feel secure, or just being confused, or like wondering if the history you're learning is indeed like consistent or something. Kind of lost my train of thought for a second. But yeah, any kind of problem that goes with just like living and living like in the South Asian context, and you want to be around people with the same questions or even new questions that can just help you. That goes along with the whole self-care, self-love kind of thing. Then definitely go, because that really helped me. I felt when I entered base, I had tons and tons of thoughts and questions, and I was like super excited to be in a place where it was like a combination of both South Asian people and really radical progressive ideas that is very rare for me to come across. And so to be around that environment really helped me figure some things out, even though really there's no never going to be a hard answer for everything. There's never going to be like an answer to a question just ends up being more questions, and that's okay. It's just the fact that like it's a process that's going to happen over and over again. That's really nice.
Great. And I want to appreciate the three of you for stepping up at such short notice to come join me tonight on the show, taking time outside of your hectic school and other schedule. And you are three of 23 participants this year, I think. So, congratulations for, you know, making it through BASE and finding it transformative. And I hope to have you back in future shows to, you know, share your analysis on the work that you're doing and maybe also doing some radio yourself. So thank you so much. And for our listeners, you can find out more about BASE online on solidaritysummer.org, and also join the Facebook community to know more about BASE, Bay Area Solidarity Summer. I'm your host, Preeti Mangalashekar. You're listening to Apex Express on KPFA 94.1 FM. We'll be back after a short music break. A beautiful exhibition called Deep Blue Sea, String of Pearls is on view at the Mission Cultural Center for Latino Arts in San Francisco. Through sculptures, prints, drawings and paintings, this Latino gallery shares space with kindred spirits from the Pacific Islands and West Coast. Apex Express producer Robin Takayama met with MCCLA's, or the Mission Cultural Center for Latino Arts' gallery coordinator, Angelica Rodriguez, and Samoan American artist Sikio Fuapopo to talk about the artwork and this connection between Latinos and indigenous people from across the Pacific. Listen up.
Angelica, can you talk a little bit about the Mission Cultural Center for Latino Arts and what the mission is and the kind of work that you generally program in the gallery space?
Yes, the Mission Cultural Center is approaching its 40th year here in the Mission District. We're at 2868 Mission Street, close to 25th Street. And its mission from the beginning has been to promote, preserve Latino art and culture. It was started by a group of students and activists that saw the lack of cultural and artistic spaces for Latinos and formed the Mission Cultural Center. And it's been here ever since. It's quite a treasure, I think, in this neighborhood in particular and for San Francisco in general.
So there's a theater, there's classrooms, but we're here in the gallery, and you're the gallery coordinator. So can you talk about the kind of exhibits that you have here and your kind of philosophy about curating the space?
Well, I program about 5 to 6 exhibits a year, and two of them are annual. One of the biggest ones is Day of the Dead during October, and then the other one is in March that coincides with International Women's Day. And we feature just an exhibit curated by a woman and only feature women artists. I really try to highlight the diversity and the cultural richness that the Latino community can have. And I'm constantly just on the lookout for people that may have some sort of vision, and really encourage a lot of people to really think of these spaces as a white canvas that they can come and participate and occupy space and really transform it and make it their own. So I tend to look for anything, any connections that we may have with other cultures and parallel paths that maybe different cultures may have. And I guess that is how Sikio and I linked up and started to develop this project.
This is a Latino cultural center, but this exhibit, Deep Blue Sea, String of Pearls, is featuring the North Star artists, which include a number of Pacific Islanders. So can you talk about that leap that you made?
I don't necessarily think it might be a leap, but more of an understanding about the similarities and the way that different cultures kind of intersect with each other, both for like the peoples of Samoa and the Pacific Islands, that there's like a parallel experience that these two cultures have had, you know, in terms of like colonialism, people trying to like maintain the rights to their lands, even like certain traditional art making or crafts making. And I've actually traveled to New Zealand and had encountered a young woman who did a lot of like a jade sculpture and jewelry. And so just by her asking me like if I was Maori, and I was like, no, I'm not Maori. She's all like, you can easily go for a Maori girl. And I was like, no, I'm Mexican. I ended up going in a museum there, and there's a lot of jade that is in the island there, and they featured a lot of replicas of like Aztec and other Mesoamerican, you know, jade sculptures that you would see at like the Anthropology Museum in Mexico City. So it kind of struck me like, wow, there's these very sort of like similarities between the cultures that I saw when I traveled down there. It just made sense to be able to feature this. And also knowing, because there's a lot of talk, you know, like, oh, a lot of the artists are leaving San Francisco or they're no longer here. And then talking to Sikio about him being pretty much raised in this neighborhood, which he may not literally be Latino, but, you know, there's an intersection. And actually he was sharing some stories about how they believe that the Polynesians actually migrated to South America, and so a lot of like the indigenous people like the Mapuche are actually from the Pacific Islands.
Sikio Fuapopo is a North Star artist. This group formed out of the San Francisco Art Institute in the 1970s. They include John Rampley, George Duran, George Shuey, and Sikio Fuapopo. For this Deep Blue Sea exhibit, Sikio invited First Nations artists and Pacific Islander artists from as far as New Zealand. But we started by talking about Sikio's roots here in San Francisco's Mission District.
I grew up in the Outer Mission. Michael Rios is one of the artists here. He and I did some murals in the Mission down in the Army Street Projects. We did a mural in Japantown called Paradise Hawaii. This was in the 70s under the CETA program. I had a studio on 18th and Cap across the street from Emmylou Packard, who's one of my very close friends. And she was a real big help with the farm workers and Cesar Chavez. But the Mission to me is like part of the city, you know, that I grew up in. And in my graduate work, I was taught by Jose Montoya and Esteban Villa were my teachers. And this is, you know, what we do as artists. We show them really that traditional art and contemporary art are one and the same, but you need to understand the history and the beauty of both. I had been going to New Zealand since 1995 at these gatherings with the other Pacific Island artists from Fiji, Tonga, Hawaii, Palau. But then I also met a lot of First Nation people there. And I think that's where I saw the similarities in our stories and in our beliefs.
As we looked at the variety of artworks in the main gallery, including drawings, sculptures, prints, and contemporary paintings, Sikio described his three large-scale paintings inspired by Samoa. the most vibrant work references a Samoan dance.
Well, in the Siva Ngefiafi, the dance of the fire, it's a person dancing, but it's the shapes of the fire as he twirls the knives around, like in a dark, like nighttime. The dancer has to become like fire himself. So he becomes like this power, but then he won't get burnt. It's kind of meditating, you know, to a state where you're just free flowing. But in that same time, he's like doing these orbits of the knives, and they're like arcs and really beautiful. And he's just, he's got two knives and he's twirling these circles around.
And is it part of a particular festival or?
It's a distinctive Samoan dance in the islands.
Another artist in the exhibit includes Regina Meredith Fitiau.
She teaches art in Pango Pango, Samoa, and her husband, Wilson Fitiau, is a master tattoo artist. Regina's work is really marvelous because she uses the traditional from her grandmother. This is her grandmother's siapo.
It looks like a stamp, but it's actually a wood carving that was made by her grandmother, mm-hmm. and it's over 100 years old. She ended up creating the paper, the fiber, the bark fiber, and then
all the women got together and they would work together collecting the dyes. It's tedious and it's very labor-intense work.
It's a very intimate and unique art practice when you're inheriting something that the grandma carved out herself, mm-hmm. passed it on, and then the granddaughter is keeping it alive in its own sense.
It's a beautiful piece of art that that we share during ceremonies, like a birth, or somebody becomes a chief, or somebody gets married. You give these treasures as a sign of your respect and happiness for them.
The center's really known for its printmaking history, so I get a lot of printmakers or print enthusiasts that come, and this is one piece that I really like to show them and kind of like highlighting again old types of printmaking that still exist and the similarities that are present, and it's absolutely beautiful. I had an older Mexican artist come in today and was looking at the artwork. He's all like, oh, this is papel amate. And so amate in pre-Columbian Mexico is actually the paper that was also made out of the barks of trees. It's very, very similar. And he was expressing earlier today to me, he's all like, I used to work this fiber back home. So it was like those instant connections with the materials themselves. And I'm just like, okay, these are similar connections that people make.
This brother's Sherrod Yonker, and he's from the Northwest Oregon coast. He's from the Chinook Wawa people from the north coast of Oregon. And he teaches carving at the Oregon School of Arts and Crafts. He teaches, canoe building, and his tribe there has gotten together with the other First Nation tribes, and they do like a canoe from village to village. And they help each other out by working together. Because on a canoe, you have to keep paddling in the same direction. And it's just the understanding that you have to work together and try to get to your destination safe. And these are like a giant mussel shell bowl. And it's really just exquisite carving skill. And there's a clam rattle. And the spoon is like from the a pitch woman spoon. It's from a story in their legends. It's elegant work, and I just love it because it's very soft. And it's somebody that really knows wood that can do that, because not everybody can make wood look like velvet, you know. It's excellent work. The thing of all these art pieces is that they're very well made and they're very professional. You know, I think people will see the difference if they come to the show, that these people do very fine work. And that's what we want to say, is that we thank anybody that comes by, but I think it'll be a treat for them.
This is the type of craftsmanship that you would see at the American Indian Market in Santa Fe, for example. They have one of the oldest indigenous First Nation marketplaces where, you know, there's competitions that go on about sculpture, carving, pottery, baskets, and nothing, and everything else, jewelry. But what has always struck me about these really old type of crafts or art making is that they're very modern. They're both made to be used, but they can stand as their own art pieces.
That was Angelica Rodriguez, the gallery coordinator at Mission Cultural Center for Latino Arts, and Sekio Fuapopo, a North Star artist. Deep Blue Sea String of Pearls is a beautiful exhibit of cross-cultural contemporary art that spans the West Coast and Pacific Islands. You have 2 weeks to catch the exhibit at the Mission Cultural Center for Latino Arts. The exhibit closes on Friday, September 9th. For more information, visit missionculturalcenter.org.
That was Apex Express producer Robin Takayama in conversation with MCCLA's gallery coordinator Angelica Rodriguez and Samoan American artist Sekio Fuapopo. And that brings us to an end of tonight's show. Please subscribe to our podcast or listen to our archives on our website, apexexpress.org. If you're interested in joining our Apex crew, if you're an Asian or Pacific Islander and have a show idea or you'd like to get involved with our collective, please email us at apex@kpfa.org. I've been your host and producer, Preeti Mangla Shekhar, with Mike Biggs on the board. Our intro and outro music is by Asian Crisis. Tune back in next week for another episode of Apex Express.